What up? This is Rama Screen covering movies, TV, and entertainment, and here's my review of Netflix's new documentary series. This is a robbery, the world's biggest heist. Hey, before you watch my review, please subscribe to my channel, press that like button, and ring that bell so you can get notified whenever I post new videos. And if you'd like to help support this channel, please do so at patreon.com/ramascreen. That's patreon.com/ramascreen. Let's rock this. I know, this is one of the craziest cases ever. It's totally bonkers. And if you look up the info on some of the paintings at their Wikipedia pages, for example, scroll down and you would notice that there's a paragraph dedicated to this theft. And in it, it says that that work of art to this day has still not yet been recovered. I guess if you're the perp who pulled this off, you should pat yourself on the back because after all these years, they still haven't caught you yet, which makes you a successful son of a gun. I'm talking, of course, about the infamous Garner Museum heist. Now, here's what I'm gonna do. First, I'm gonna tell you what I think of this documentary. I'm gonna break it down in details. And then I'm gonna share with you my overall thought about this whole case and why I think there's plenty of blame to go around. This is a robbery. The world's biggest art heist is chilling, it's absorbing, it's puzzling, and its theories and speculations will stay in your heads for days on end. It was the biggest art heist in history. Over St. Patrick's Day weekend in 1990, legendary works by Rembrandt, Vermeer, and others worth over $500 million today, were stolen from the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Boston. This four-part documentary series from director Colin Barnicle covers the leads, dead ends, lucky breaks that characterize the investigation of this still unsolved mystery. So the first part gives you the overview of what went down on that fateful day from the eyewitness accounts to the two fake cops, to the duct tape security guard in the basement. They don't waste any precious time in letting you know that what you're about to see is jaw-dropping. Simultaneously, it's also an overview of the museum itself, the history behind it, and its breathtaking architecture, and its marvelous collection of plants right in the middle of its courtyard that looks like the mini version of the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. The second episode takes into consideration the question of, could this have been an inside job? Because there's no way anybody could have done that deed without some help from somebody who works there, right? This does venture into conspiracy theories since no real hard evidence is ever presented. But boy, does this episode get your imagination run wild. The third episode takes a broader perspective, specifically the city of Boston, the neighborhoods there, and their underworld secrets. Here you'll see a few possible suspects with a few possible motives, but still, it goes from one fruitless pursuit to the next. And finally, the last episode suddenly turns into something out of a Martin Scorsese movie. You know, mob bosses, people getting whacked, organized crime. The fourth episode doesn't feel like it's about Garner Museum anymore. It feels more like Goodfellas. Throughout them all, it's clear that this docu wants to place you as some sort of a pseudo-active participant in this investigation. In fact, the ways in which it details the robbery, complete with the computer graphics of the blueprint of where the rooms are and which rooms carry which paintings, it's kind of like a Mission Impossible type situation. And the more angles to the theories, the more you want to connect the dots. It's like you're playing this giant game of clues. The reenactments are the thing that sends chills down your spine. Usually, you would see this on Netflix crime docus about murders and serial killers and crime of passion. So to have that done here, for an art heist adds a sense of suspense, especially when the filmmakers showcase an alternative, like reenactments of what could have happened to the security guard had his fate been different. Because this is still an open case, or worse, a cold case, the mystery continues. You can even categorize the nature or the purpose of this docu as just another round of PSA announcement asking the public for help if they happen to know the whereabouts of these masterpieces. And nobody would blame the docu for doing that. After 30 years of no result, this docu can help keep the interest alive. So maybe a new fresh pair of eyes from the generation that wasn't around in 1990 could chip in somehow. And so, here are my final thoughts about this whole case. When you come across stories like this, you can't help but think of Hollywood romanticized version of heist. You know, in the back of your head, you can't help but be impressed a little. Maybe they're George Clooney's gang from Ocean's 11, or maybe it's a Thomas Crown affair. There is a part of us rooting for the one sticking it to the hoity-toities. On the other hand, I mean it when I said earlier, there's plenty of blame to go around. Just think about it. Prior to the theft, Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum took potential threats lightly, and they had on the most half-assed security system even for the standards of that time. The cops also took this case lightly. You would think that after two burglars impersonating them, that they would feel so offended or violated, they would be on this thing like a hawk targeting its prey. But nope, safe to say it went straight to the bottom of their pile. Would the robbery have been solved if it had happened today? It's hard to say, but one thing for sure, a lot of people involved with that incident dropped the ball in 1990. This is Robbery, the World's Biggest Art Heist, is the latest fascinating documentary you won't get enough of.